All right, we're here once again to do our Bible study of the Dead Sea Scrolls. I posted on my Facebook the link to the book that we're going to be studying through. This is the Book of Abraham. So if you can, please turn to the page of the Book of Abraham. Turn it to that PDF file. In the PDF file, we are going to start on page, let's see, the page number is, it'll say 88 in the actual PDF, and it'll say 69 in the book. So 69 for the book, 88 for the PDF file. So please turn there. All right, we've got Dan with us. Dan, the website I posted as my Facebook status is the book we are going to be studying through, and we are on page 88 or 69 in that book. So if you can turn to there, that would be great. Okay. All right, so it starts off with the beginning of the Book of Abraham is missing in this scroll. And the reason it's missing is because through the process of time, the fragments or the scroll starts to deteriorate, and just through time or through insects or just the weather or the humidity, all different factors can result in the scroll deteriorating. And unfortunately for this Genesis Apocryphon, that's what the scholars call it, it was three different books that were found, Book of Lamech, Book of Noah, and Book of Abraham, all in a single scroll. But it was poorly preserved, with the beginning and the end of the scroll missing, the middle section is missing, and there's fragments all throughout the whole thing. So that's very disappointing. But what we do have is enough to confirm a lot of truths for us, a lot of amazing things. And so that's what we're going to be studying through today. So let's see here. Second. All right. So column 19 is where we will begin. We see it starts with Abraham talking himself. He says, I called there on the name of God, and I said, you are, I said, you are God, and then there's some words missing, and he says, and King of Eternity. Now the King of Eternity, that is a phrase used in other scriptures, like in the books of Enoch, where he says, King of the Ages. And that's the same thing as the King of Eternity. And so that's a connection with these ancient documents. Then he says, and he spoke with me in the night. And it says, and take strength to wander. Up to now you have not reached the holy mountain. So I set out. Now we go to the next page. I set out to go there. I was going to the south of Moreh. I went until I reached Hebron. Now I built Hebron for that region, and I lived there for 2 years. Now there was a famine in all of this land, but I heard that there was wheat in Egypt, so I set out to go. So when you see dot 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 in the PDF file, That means there's some words missing. And if you see brackets with nothing in between the brackets, that's because it's missing there. And when you see brackets and there's a word inside or a letter inside, that's their reconstruction, because that part was not preserved in the scroll. But the scholars, using their abilities to understand the language, it was found in Aramaic. So their ability to understand the Aramaic helps them fill in some of the missing portions, as well as the context of the narrative. So then he says, to the land that is in Egypt. And there was, I reached the Carmen River, one of the heads of the river. I said, enter. Now we have been within our land. So I crossed over the seven heads of this river, which afterwards enters into the great sea of salt. After this, I said, now we have left our land and entered the land of the sons of Ham, the land of Egypt. Now I, Abram, dreamt a dream in the night of my entry into Egypt. I saw in my dream that there was a single cedar and a single date. A single date palm. We're on the next page now. Having sprouted together from one root. And men came seeking to cut down and uproot the cedar, thereby leaving the date palm by itself. But the date palm cried out and said, do not cut down the cedar, for the two of us are sprung from one root. So the cedar was left on account of the date palm, and they did not cut me down. Then I awoke in the night from my sleep, and I said to my wife Sarai, I dreamt a dream. On account of this dream, I am afraid. She said to me, tell me your dream, so that I may know. So I began to tell her this dream, and I said to her, this dream, that they will seek to kill me, but to spare you. Therefore, this is the entire kind deed that you must do for me. In all cities that we will enter, say of me, he is my brother. I will live under your protection, and my life will be spared because of you. Then he says, they will seek to take you away from me and to kill me. Sarai wept because of my words that night. Now I'll stop there for a second. Already we're seeing some amazing extra details here that's not even in Genesis. We've got, first of all, he starts off with how he's traveling around through the Promised Land to see all the places that he's going to inherit. And he's going around and seeing which places belong to who. Then he also tells us that he actually built Hebron. We see Hebron mentioned in the scripture, but we don't know the origin of Hebron. What we see right here, he actually built Hebron for that region. And then he lived there for 2 years. So that's an amazing thing. And then he talks about the famine and how he heard, and how he goes over to Egypt because of the famine. But something that's very amazing is the dream that we saw here. No other writing tells of this dream, but Abraham's own book here tells us the dream he had. And it proves to us that Abraham was actually not in the wrong. He was not sinning when he did what he did, because this was a dream from God that told him that he was going to be in danger, and what he had to do was for his sister to say that she was the sister in order to spare his life. Many people have talked about this passage in Genesis and tried to make it look like Abraham was being evil for it. But that's actually a misunderstanding, and it's that interpretation comes because we don't have this missing, we don't have this passage from Abraham. So a lot of people read into the text and think that Abraham was lying or not being faithful, but he was actually being faithful because he received a dream that told him what to do. So already this helps us to know that a lot of what people are teaching is wrong. But so Abraham then continues and says, when we entered into the district of Egypt, then he says, and Pharaoh Zoan. Now I've seen other translations. Some say the Pharaoh of Zoan. Others say the Pharaoh Zoan. A problem is in Aramaic and Hebrew, when you say of, sometimes it's unclear if you're... Basically, when you say of in Hebrew and Aramaic, you don't always need to put a word there. So, like, when you say in Hebrew, son of God, or son of man, there's only two words there. It's just son man, or son God. And it can mean son of man, or son of God. And it can also mean son God. So the of there is based on context, whether it's talking about of something or not. So here the translators differ, and they say Pharaoh of Zoan, and other translations say Pharaoh Zoan. So that's an important difference there. So Abraham continues and says, Sarai to turn toward Zoan. And then Abraham says, she worried herself greatly that no man should see her for 5 years. Now, at the end of those 5 years, to me, and three men from the nobles of Egypt, his, by Pharaoh Zoan, because of my words and my wisdom, and they were giving, and we go to the next page, page 73 or 92, so they gave me many. They were giving me many gifts, he says. And then he says, and they asked scribal knowledge. Oh, sorry. I keep forgetting to turn that off. It's an alarm. They asked scribal knowledge and wisdom and truth for themselves. So I read before them the book of the words of Enoch. That's amazing right here. We're seeing that Abraham had the book of the words of Enoch, and he read it to the Egyptians to teach them righteousness and truth. And so the Egyptians, they have a calendar. Their calendar is the solar calendar, a 360-day calendar, and that's the same calendar that Enoch talks of. And there's a lot of other similarities between the scriptures, the Bible, and Egyptian religion. There's a lot of parallels. So this suggests that a lot of Egyptian mythology, a lot of Egyptian concepts may actually be originating from Enoch and some of his teachings and some of the biblical scriptures. So he reads to them the book of Enoch to teach them righteousness and wisdom and truth. And then he says, Abraham says, in the womb in which he had grown, they were not going to get up until I would clearly expound for them the words of, and he says, with much eating and much drinking. And there's a mention of the wine. And so this section here is all kind of very patchy. It's hard to see what he's saying. In line 29, we see all the words of Enoch. So we see it's still focusing on teaching them about Enoch. We're missing like six lines, lines 30 to 35, as we can see. Then we go to the next page, column 20. It's on page 93 or 74. And you see in line 2, what we see now is we're in the middle of a passage where they are praising the beauty of Sarah, how amazingly attractive she is. So here's what they say. How irresistible and beautiful is the image of her face, how lovely her forehead, and soft the hair of her head, how graceful are her eyes, and how precious her nose. Every feature of her face is radiating beauty. How lovely is her breast, and how beautiful her white complexion. As for her arms, how beautiful they are, and her hands, how perfect they are. Every view of her hands is stimulating. How graceful are her palms, and how long and thin all the fingers of her hands. Her legs are of such beauty, and her thighs so perfectly apportioned. There is not a thigh, excuse me, my bad, I misread there. There is not a virgin or bride who enters the bridal chamber more beautiful than she. Her beauty surpasses that of all women, since the height of her beauty soars above them all. And alongside all this beauty, she possesses great wisdom. Everything about her is lovely. Now when the king heard the words of Hyrcanus and his two companions, that the three of them spoke as one, he greatly desired her, and sent someone to be quick in acquiring her. When he saw her, he was dumbfounded at all of her beauty, and took her for himself as a wife. He also sought to kill me. But Sarai said to the king, he is my brother, so that I would benefit on account of her. Thus I, Abram, was spared because of her and was not killed. I, Abram, wept bitterly, I and Lot, my brother's son, with me, on the night when Sarai was taken from me by force. That night I prayed and entreated and asked for mercy. Through sorrow and streaming tears I said, blessed are you, Most High God, my Lord, for all ages, for you are the Lord and ruler over everything. You are sovereign over all the kings of the earth, having power to enact judgment on all of them. So now I lodge my complaint before you, my Lord, concerning Pharaoh Zoan, king of Egypt, for my wife has been taken from me forcefully. Bring judgment against him on my behalf, and reveal your mighty hand through him and all of his house, that he might not prevail this night in rendering my wife unclean for me. Thus they will come to know you, my Lord, that you are Lord over all the kings of the earth. So I wept and was deeply troubled. During that night, the Most High God sent a pestilential spirit to afflict him and to every person of his household, an evil spirit. It was an ongoing affliction for him and every person of his household, so that he was not able to approach her, nor did he have sexual relations with her. She was with him for 2 years, and at the end of 2 years, the afflictions and hardships grew heavier and more powerful over him and every person of his household. So he sent a message to all the wise men of Egypt, and to all the magicians, in addition to all the physicians of Egypt, if they could heal him and the people of his household. Hold on. Hey, can you turn your mic off, please? Okay. Good to have you. So continuing. In addition to all the physicians of Egypt, if they could heal him and the people of his household of this affliction. But all of the physicians and magicians and all of the wise men were not able to succeed in curing him, for the spirit began afflicting all of them, so that they fled the scene. At this point, Hyrcanus came to me, asking that I could pray over the king and lay my hands upon him, so that he would live. This was because he had seen me in a dream. But Lot said to him, Abram, my uncle, cannot pray over the king while his wife Sarai is with him. Now go and tell the king that he should send his wife away from himself to her husband. Then he will pray over him so that he might live. Now when Hyrcanus heard the words of Lot, he went, saying to the king, all these afflictions and hardships that are afflicting and troubling my lord the king are due to Sarai, the wife of Abram. Just return Sarai to Abram, her husband, and this affliction and the spirit of foulness will depart from you. So the king called me and said to me, what have you done to me? Why were you saying to me, she is my sister, when she was your wife, so that I took her as a wife for myself? Here is your wife, take her, go and get yourself out of every district of Egypt. But now pray over me and my household that this evil spirit may be driven away from us. So I prayed over him that I might heal him, and I laid my hands upon his head. Thus the affliction was removed from him, and the evil spirit driven away from him. The king recovered, rose up, and gave to me on that day many gifts, and the king swore to me by an oath that he did not have sexual relations with her, nor did he defile her. Then he returned Sarai to me, and the king gave to her much silver and gold, and much clothing of fine linen and purple, which, and it says, before her, as well as Hagar. Thus he restored her to me, and appointed for me a man who would escort me from Egypt to, and it says, to your people, to you. And then Abraham says, now I, Abram, grew tremendously in many flocks, and also in silver and gold. I went up from Egypt, and my brother's son Lot went with me. Lot had also acquired for himself many flocks and took a wife for himself from the daughters of Egypt. I'll stop there for a second. So that is an amazing extra detail that's not in Genesis anywhere. And it really fills in a lot of things and actually changes a lot of what what Scripture is actually telling us. Because when people read Genesis, they read in a lot of ideas. And so we see here that how long they were there. They were there for 2 whole years. She was kidnapped by Pharaoh for 2 years, it says. We don't have any hint of that in Genesis. And all this extra detail is amazing. Do you guys have Genesis opened in another tab? If you don't, can you open Genesis and whatever translation you like to use? And I'm going to read from the parallel passage just to show you and point out to you guys how the account we just read is much fuller. So it's in chapter 12, okay? That's where we are starting. Chapter 12 of Genesis. So if you want to follow along, you can, or you can just listen. I'm reading from the Septuagint version, so you'll notice there's some extra stuff sometimes, some extra details in the Septuagint version. But so here we see, it says, "And the Lord said to Abram, Go forth out of thy land, and out of thy kindred, and out of the house of thy father, and come into the land which I will show thee. And I will make thee a great nation, and I will bless thee and magnify thy name, and thou shalt be blessed. And I will bless those that bless thee, and curse those that curse thee, and in thee shall all the tribes of the earth be blessed. And Abram went as the Lord spoke to him, and Lot departed with him, and Abram was 75 years old when he went out of Haran. And Abram took Sarai his wife, and Lot the son of his brother, and all their possessions, as many as they had got, and every soul which they had got in Haran, and they went forth to go into the land of Canaan. And Abram traversed the land lengthwise as far as the place Shechem to the high oak, and the Canaanites then inhabited the land. And the Lord appeared to Abram and said to him, I will give this land to thy seed. And Abram built an altar there to the Lord who appeared to him, and he departed thence to the mountain eastward of Bethel, and there he pitched his tent in Bethel near the sea, and Ai toward the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord, and called on the name of the Lord. And Abram departed and went and encamped in the wilderness." All that right there, about how the Lord appeared to him and said, I will give this land to you and your seed. And then he built an altar. All that's actually was in the book of Abraham in that beginning section, which was really fragmentary. As I was reading earlier, he's going throughout the land and looking at the different places, going to the different places. And that's the same thing we have right here, where Abram traverses the land. And now here, it continues in Genesis, verse 10, "And there was a famine in the land, and Abram went down to Egypt to sojourn there, because the famine prevailed in the land. And it came to pass, when Abram drew nigh to enter into Egypt, Abram said to Sarah his wife, I know that thou art a fair woman. It shall come to pass then that when the Egyptians shall see thee, they shall say, This is his wife, and they shall slay me, but they shall save thee alive. Say therefore, I am his sister, that it may be well with thee, with me on account of thee, and my soul shall live because of thee." So right there, we see no indication of a dream at all. This is just Abram coming up with his own ideas. That's what it seems like Genesis is telling us. He just says, do this for me, please. So it paints a very different picture, because there's some missing information. And so then it continues, "And it came to pass, when Abram entered into Egypt, the Egyptians having seen his wife, that she was very beautiful, that the princes of Pharaoh saw her and praised her to Pharaoh and brought her into the house of Pharaoh." Right there, we have two things which Genesis omits. It omits that entire thing about how they went on and on about how amazingly attractive she was, her body parts and stuff like that, you know. And then it also omits, it actually says in the book of Abraham It says, "And Pharaoh sought to kill me." We have no hint of that in Genesis. Genesis makes it sound like Abram was just crazy ideas in his head, which, you know, who said they were going to try to kill him for his wife? Well, we know the truth. Abram tells us, in his own words, he had a dream which told him it was going to happen, that they wanted to kill him. And then it indeed happened, where Pharaoh was thinking in his mind, "I'm going to try to kill this guy because I want her for myself." And when he realized, when he saw the Pharaoh and realized that this dream was being fulfilled, he said, "Okay, remember what we talked about, Sarah, do this for me." And then Sarah obeyed what he had asked her to do. And this principle, some people will think about what Abram did and compare it to, they'll say it's a horrible thing that he did. And they'll say the same thing about Lot and his family. But the basic idea here, the principle on their mind that they're thinking of, is this. What is worse, to be murdered or to be raped? That's the difference. Now, some people might differ and say they'd rather die than be raped. But many people would say, even though rape is a horrible and traumatic thing, I have so many friends and family that I love, and the whole this world I love being here, and there's so many good things to offer and to experience and live, that I would choose rape over the murder. And so that's the principle that Lot, for instance, was establishing for his family. He said, "Okay, the sin that you guys want to do is much worse than the sin of if you were to do this to my daughters." Basically, he's trying to make a peace offering with Lot. Lot's trying to make a peace offering with these men, because these men are trying to commit a horribly horrible sin, and Lot's saying it would be preferable if you were to do this lesser sin. And that's the same thing that Abraham is doing here. He's saying, go with Pharaoh, and if he does something against you, then he will be punished by God. And I'm gonna pray so that you'll be protected, and try to protect yourself from him. Try to not let it happen, but do this for me, because if you don't, then he's gonna kill me. This was not an example of a lack of faith, as we see from Abraham's book, that he was fearing for his life, that he was going to be killed. Because why? The prophets, very righteous men, all throughout Scripture, have died, been murdered. The law of Moses and the prophets and everything do not give any guarantee for your life. They do not say, if you obey the commandments, you will not be killed. You can't assume that God will protect your life. Like with the apostles, they had the power of the Holy Spirit, and they could do all kinds of miracles. Almost all the apostles died. They were murdered, almost all of them. And that's because the power of the Holy Spirit has a greater plan and focus than not. It's not just about you. It's not just about us. And so, if your death will actually benefit other people in the long run, then the Holy Spirit will allow for that to happen. So that's why the Messiah died, because in the long run, his death would be beneficial for the world. And for each righteous person that dies, God allows it to happen when he could have prevented it, for a purpose, for his overall purpose. And we often will not know what that purpose is, but it's like with Job. Job, he lost his family, and he had horrible sickness happen to him. This was allowed for a purpose, a greater purpose. Look at how many people read the book of Job and are inspired by his book. If that had not happened to Job, then that book would never have been written, that story would have never happened, and we wouldn't be able to be blessed by what happened to him and to be encouraged through our walks. So there's things like that we have to take into consideration, that just because Abram was afraid for his life does not mean that he was unfaithful or unrighteous. He was just trying to make sure that he did everything he could to continue his life. So, in other words, you know, if it's like someone could make the argument, if you have faith, you'll just let God do everything for you. But that's ridiculous. You know, you have to do your part. Why should God save your life or help you when you're not doing what you should do to protect yourself? So if you're driving down the highway and you're drunk driving and you're driving all over the place and you're being ridiculous and not a safe driver, why should God have to intervene and protect you when you are not making wise and smart choices? So it's on us too to protect our own lives and to make sure we don't die. So Abraham here was trying to do that because he wasn't assuming that God was going to help him. He was trying to do his part and then leave the rest to God. So we see a much different story than what Genesis seems to be saying. And Rob mentions about how Lot, in his judgment, that it might have corrupted his judgment, but it seems to me like in the New Testament, it actually refers to Lot as the righteous Lot, and how when he was living in Sodom, he was seeing their sin that they did, and he was grieving in his heart over the sin of Sodom. And so it seems to me that, you know, people don't necessarily have to agree with this. This is just my perspective here. It seems to me that what Lot did is very similar to what Abram did here. Abraham said, okay, Pharaoh can take... When Pharaoh said, okay, give me your sister, he said, okay, you can have my sister. Here she is. And that's kind of what Lot was doing here. What Lot did in his situation. He said, I cannot give you these men, plus these are angels, so, you know, angels are above humans, so he felt an obligation to protect these men, and said, please do not rape these men, because raping these men would be homosexuality, it would be rape, and it would be sinning against angels. That's three major, major sins in one, whereas Lot was giving... If they had the daughters instead, it would not be sin against angels, it would not be homosexual sin, but it would still be the rape sin. So he was trying to judge. Perhaps it was not the best judgment on his part, but that's what he probably was thinking of. Okay, the lesser of two evils. Whatever I do, they're gonna force their way in. So I'll try to choose the lesser of two evils. Him offering up his daughters is not forcing the people to rape his daughters. It is still the choice and the act of the other people. So he's trying to do whatever he can to protect the two men. And so I guess that's kind of how I view it. But it is definitely a difficult passage. A lot of people, you know, when they read that, they think that Lot was a very horrible person. But Lot was in a very difficult situation, and he did not know what to do, and he tried to do the most righteous thing he could in that situation to diffuse the wickedness in their hearts. And the daughters, then, afterwards, as we know in Genesis, then they commit major sin, and Lot also is partially guilty of the sin as well. Even though he was drunk, he's still accountable for his actions, just like every drunk person is accountable for their actions. And so they did have some, there were probably some corruption living in Sodom that entered into their minds, especially the daughters anyway. Because it says that Lot was righteous in the New Testament, at least he was. But as for his daughters, it does not say that they were ever righteous. So it may be the case that his daughters were actually not holy at all. And they were only saved, perhaps, on account of Lot. Let's see here. So going back to Genesis, it says, verse 16, And they treated Abram well on her account, and he had sheep and calves and asses and men servants and women servants and mules and camels. And God afflicted Pharaoh with great and severe afflictions and his house because of Sarah, Abram's wife. And Pharaoh, having called Abram, said, What is this thou hast done to me, that thou didst not tell me that she was thy wife? Wherefore didst thou say, She is my sister, and I took her for a wife to myself? And now, behold, thy wife is before thee. Take her and go quickly away. And Pharaoh gave charge to men concerning Abram to join in sending him forward, and his wife, and all that he had. So right there, that account of Genesis, it's so much briefer, and it gives you a very different impression of the story. It basically tells us, like, God afflicts Pharaoh, and then somehow Pharaoh finds out. We don't even know in Genesis how he found out. We just, all of a sudden, we see Pharaoh calls Abram and says, What have you done? Why did you do this to me? Well, how did Pharaoh know? Well, Genesis doesn't tell us how Pharaoh knew. But Abraham tells us the story. So Genesis is clearly missing holes. It has holes to the story. It's not sufficient to have a full understanding of what happened here. You see that all throughout Genesis. There's missing holes all throughout where it tells you a story, but you don't understand, like, what? How did that happen? There's more. There must be more to the story here because it's the way it's being told. It's like referring or alluding to things which haven't been explained properly. Just like, as I said, Pharaoh was accusing Abraham of doing this, but he had no reason to suspect him. According to Genesis, there was no reason. So how did that happen? Then perhaps God told him it was Abraham, or Sarah confessed, or something, but we don't know. Genesis doesn't tell us. But Abraham tells us in his book. So why is that? Why doesn't Genesis tell us? Well, because Moses, when he wrote the book of Genesis, what he did was he used the other books. So he used Noah's book, Abraham's book, Jacob's book, Joseph's book. He used all those books, and he was trying to create a summary, a condensed version of the narrative. So the purpose for that is to give you an overall view of the main essence of narrative of the story. But for the rest of the information, you're referred to the source text, the primary source texts. We actually see that in 1st and 2nd Chronicles. If you read through that sometime, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, you're going to read through it. And for each of the kings, you'll see, and the rest of the acts of this king, they are written in this book, and this book, and this book. By implication, the other books had a much more detailed information about the lives of these kings. And so, it's the same thing here. Just like 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Genesis is an account, a highly condensed account, of all these writings of the patriarchs. And so Moses took those books, he was interpreting those books, and he tried to shorten it so that it wouldn't be like a super huge book. He wanted so that it could be an introductory course to the history of Israel. And so that's why Genesis is so insufficient, because he actually intended it to be He intended it to not cover everything. He didn't want it to cover everything because he wanted us to ask questions and seek the answers in the older writings. Yes, it is a severely condensed book. I mean, chapter 6, verse 4 of Genesis, or chapter 6 of Genesis, the account for the Nephilim and the Watchers, that's like one little thing, tiny little thing, whereas we know there was a whole book of Enoch that was written, a whole book of this, a whole book of that, about these things. A righteous man can make a bad decision at times, but there's two ways to understand that. A bad decision can be non-sinful, and it can also be sinful. So, In the New Testament, you'll read in 1 John chapter 3, it says, Anyone who is born of God does not sin because they cannot sin. So right there we're seeing someone who is a righteous man does not sin, and cannot be sinning, because if he is sinning, he's no longer a righteous man. In the case of David, when he made that bad decision, it wasn't just a mistake or an innocent, you know, a non-sinful bad thing that he did, but it was a really evil sin that he did, and that caused him to fall from righteousness. He was not righteous during that year of he lived in sin, and you were not righteous when you live in sin. So David lived in sin. Even he was a righteous man, but he had made a bad decision, which caused him to become a bad, unrighteous person. But when he repented and turned away from his sin with true sincerity of heart, he returned to righteousness, and he became once again a man after God's heart. So now let me go to Jubilee's. I'm going to go to Jubilee's account here. And let me see here, just checking the parallel account of Jubilees. It's in chapter... Basically, in Jubilees, we have a whole thing of the missing beginning. Of this missing beginning was probably all in the book of Abraham, but it's all gone now because the beginning of the book is missing in the scroll that was found. Sadly, but we have Jubilees, which preserves for us the essence of the beginning, and it's an amazing beginning what we see here. So then, let's see, chapter. Hold on. Chapter 13. That's where it begins. Jubilees chapter 13. So watch this. We'll see. It says, we'll see that Jubilees and the book of Abraham are connecting. They're connecting. So it says, chapter 13, and Abram journeyed from Haran, and he took Sarai his wife and Lot his brother Haran's son to the land of Canaan, and he came into Ashur, and proceeded to Shechem, and dwelt near a lofty oak. And he saw, and behold, the land was very pleasant, from the entering of Hamath to the lofty oak. And the Lord said to him, to thee and to thy seed will I give this land. And he built an altar there, and he offered thereon a burnt sacrifice to the Lord, who had appeared to him. And he removed from thence unto the mountain, Bethel, on the west, and Ai on the east, and pitched his tent there. And he saw, and behold, the land was very good, very wide and good, and everything grew thereon, vines and figs and pomegranates, oaks and ilexes and terebinths and oil trees and cedars and cypresses and date trees and all trees of the field, and there was water on the mountains. And he blessed the Lord who had led him out of Ur of the Chaldees and had brought him to this land. And it came to pass in the first year, in the seventh week, on the new moon of the first month, that he built an altar on this mountain, and called on the name of the Lord, Thou, the Eternal God, art my God. And he offered on the altar a burnt sacrifice unto the Lord, that he should be with him, and not forsake him all the days of his life. And he removed from thence, and went towards the south, and he came to Hebron, and Hebron was built at that time, and he dwelt there 2 years. And he went into the land of the south, to Baaloth, and there was a famine in the land. So right there, the mention of Hebron being built at that time, and he was there for 2 years, that's exactly what Book of Abraham says. It's not in Genesis, but both, we have two witnesses here, Jubilees and Book of Abraham, saying he was in Hebron 2 years after Hebron had been built at that time. Then he says, then it says in Jubilees, and Abram went into Egypt in the third year of the week, and he dwelt in Egypt 5 years. Before his wife was torn away from him. That's exactly what it says in Book of Abraham, that they were there for 5 years. She hid herself for 5 years. Then Jubilees continues, now Timnah in Egypt at that time was built 7 years after Hebron. I think Timnah is Zoan, if I remember correctly. And then it says in Jubilees, and it came to pass when Pharaoh seized Sarai, the wife of Abram, that the Lord plagued Pharaoh and his house with great plagues, because of Sarai, Abram's wife. And Abram was very glorious by reason of possessions and sheep and cattle, and asses and horses and camels and men servants and maid servants, and in silver and gold exceedingly. And Lot also his brother's son was wealthy. And Pharaoh gave back Sarai, the wife of Abram, and he sent him out of the land of Egypt. And he journeyed to the place where he had pitched his tent at the beginning, to the place of the altar with Ai on the east and Bethel on the west, and he blessed the Lord his God who had brought him back in peace. So we see there a striking connection between Jubilees and the Book of Abraham. Now, I go back to the Book of Abraham. It's page 96 and also page 77 in the PDF file. Line 34. I was encamping with him. Now we go to the next page. Every place of my encampments until I reached Bethel, the place where I had built the altar. I built it a second time. So that's what I just read in Jubilees. So he's saying the same thing here. Built it a second time and offered upon it burnt offerings and a meal offering to the Most High God. And I called there on the name of the Lord of the ages. I praised the name of God, blessed God, and gave thanks there before God because of all the flocks and good things that he had given to me, because he had worked good on my behalf and returned me to this land in peace. After this day, Lot parted from me due to the behavior of our shepherds. He went and settled in the Jordan Valley along with all of his flocks. And I also added a great deal to his belongings. As he was pasturing his flocks, he reached Sodom and bought a house for himself in Sodom. He lived in it while I was living on the mountain of Bethel. And it was disturbing to me that Lot, my brother's son, had parted from me. Then God appeared to me in a vision in the night and said to me, "Go up to Ramat Hazor, which is to the north of Bethel, the place where you are living. Lift up your eyes and look to the east, to the west, to the south, and to the north, and see this entire land that I am giving to you and to your descendants for all ages." So on the following day I went up to Ramat Hazor, and I saw all the land from this high point, from the river of Egypt up to Lebanon and Senir, and from the Great Sea to Haran, and all the land of Gebel up to Kadesh, and the entire great desert that is east of Horan and Senir, up to the Euphrates. He said to me, "To your descendants I will give all this land, and they will inherit it for all ages. I will make your descendants as numerous as the dust of the earth, which no one is able to reckon. So too will your descendants be beyond reckoning. Get up, walk around, go and see how great are its length and its width. For I shall give it to you and to your descendants, and you unto all the ages." I'll stop there for a second. There was a question asked, is this writing also called the Testament of Abraham? No, it's not called the Testament of Abraham. That's a very different book, and that one's much more unreliable. I think Testament of Abraham is probably scripture, but it's in a very corrupt form, and I don't trust it much. So that's a different book. This is the Book of Abraham. It's in the Dead Sea Scrolls in a scroll that the scholars call the Genesis Apocryphon. The scholars think that this book, Genesis Apocryphon, is a book that covers multiple patriarchs' lives. But in reality, it's not one book, it's multiple books in a single scroll. Just like you have the Law of Moses, five different books, sometimes in a single scroll, in the same way, this scroll, the Genesis Apocryphon, was actually multiple books in a single scroll. And so this is in the Genesis Apocryphon, the Book of Abraham. And so then Abraham continues and says, "So I, Abram, embarked to hike around and look at the land. I began to travel the circuit from the Gihon River and came alongside the sea until I reached Mount Taurus. I then traversed from along this great sea of salt and went alongside Mount Taurus to the east through the breadth of the land until I reached the Euphrates River. I journeyed along the Euphrates until I reached the Erythraean Sea to the east and was traveling along the Erythraean Sea until I reached the Gulf of the Red Sea, which extends out from the Erythraean Sea. I went around to the south until I reached the Gihon River, and I then returned, arriving at my house in safety. I found all of my people safe and went and settled at the Oaks of Mamre, which are near Hebron, to the northeast of Hebron. I built an altar there and offered upon it a burnt offering and a meal offering to the Most High God. I ate and drank there, I and every person of my household. I also sent an invitation to Mamre, Arnem, and Eshcol, three Amorite brothers, my friends, and they ate and drank together with me. Now stop there. I'm going to go and read from Genesis again, the parallel section. So chapter 13. And Abram went up out of Egypt, he and his wife, and all that he had, and Lot with him, into the wilderness. And Abram was very rich in cattle and silver and gold. And he went whence he came into the wilderness as far as Bethel, as far as the place where his tent was before, between Bethel and Ai, to the place of the altar, which he built there at first. And Abram there called on the name of the Lord. And Lot, who went out with Abram, had sheep and oxen and tents. And the land was not large enough for them to live together, because their possessions were great. And the land was not large enough for them to live together. And there was a strife between the herdmen of Abram's cattle and the herdmen of Lot's cattle. And the Canaanites and the Perizzites then inhabited the land. And Abram said to Lot, Let there not be a strife between me and thee, and between my herdmen and thy herdmen, for we are brethren. Lo, is not the whole land before thee? And separate thyself from me. If thou goest to the left, I will go to the right. If thou goest to the right, I will go to the left. And Lot, having lifted up his eyes, observed all the country round about Jordan, that it was all watered before God overthrew Sodom and Gomorrah, as the garden of the Lord, and as the land of Egypt, until thou come to Zorah. And Lot chose for himself all the country round Jordan, and Lot went from the east, and they were separated, each from his brother. And Abram dwelt in the land of Canaan. And Lot dwelt in a city of the neighboring people, and pitched his tent in Sodom. But the men of Sodom were evil and exceedingly sinful before God. And God said to Abram after Lot was separated from him, Look up with thine eyes, and behold from the place where thou now art, northward, and southward, and eastward, and seaward, for all the land which thou seest, I will give it to thee and to thy seed forever. And I will make thy seed like the dust of the earth. If anyone is able to number the dust of the earth, then shall thy seed be numbered. Arise and traverse the land, both in the length of it and in the breadth, for to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. And Abram, having removed his tent, came and dwelt by the oak of Mamre, which was in Hebron, and he built there an altar to the Lord. So we're told right there that Abraham was commanded to arise and traverse the land, and we don't see, like, Genesis kind of skips over that, whereas in Abraham's book, he tells us how he went place by place, and he traversed the land, and he documents the place he went, and places he goes are the same places geographically which Jubilees tells us, and the book of Noah that was found in this same scroll, the Genesis Apocryphon scroll, the land was allotted to the three sons, to Shem, Ham, and Japheth, all the land of the earth. And the land that Abraham was walking are the same borders that Noah mentions in his book and that Jubilees also mentions in. So that's a further connection and reinforcement. Now, there is a thing that scholars say which they are actually ignorant of, and that is what we noticed here is that in the book of Abraham, all we see Abraham says is, he says, all he says is, after this day, Lot parted from me due to the behavior of our shepherds. That's all he says. But Genesis tells us a conversation they had. He talks with his brother, or his with his nephew, and says, Let there not be strife between me and thee, and between the herdsmen. We are brothers. Choose which land you want to go. They have that conversation. That's not mentioned in the book of Abraham here. So scholars say that the writer, they don't think Abraham wrote this. They think some random person, random Jew, wrote this scroll of Abraham, and just for fun, for some reason. And they decided to remove the conversation. That's their faulty thinking. That's what the scholars say. However, I found in Jubilees the actual reason it's not here. Because it's later on in the book of Abraham, in the part that we're no longer having anymore. Because in the scroll that was found, the end of Abraham is gone. It's completely missing. The ending was actually cut off by someone in ancient times. The scholars could tell that someone had cut off the rest of the scroll. So it was probably because it was such a large scroll that they had to separate it into two different scrolls to carry it. And so I found in Jubilees where it actually tells us why Abraham doesn't talk about it here, because he talks about it in a different place later on. So here's what it says in Jubilees. You see here. Okay, so Jubilee 17:3 says, this is Abraham, talking about Abraham, it says, "And he remembered the words which he had spoken to him on the day on which Lot had parted from him. And he rejoiced because the Lord had given him seed upon the earth to inherit the earth, and he blessed with all his mouth the Creator of all things." So basically, in the book of Abraham, we see that Abraham here just says, Lot parted from me because of our behavior of our shepherds. But then way later in the book of Abraham, he remembers the words spoken to him by Lot on that day. So he recollects and recounts it. So way later in it, he's talking about those words. So if we had the full scroll of Abraham, we would have seen that conversation later on in the book, according to Jubilees. So let's see here. Now I'm going to read from Jubilees section, which corresponds with what we just read in Abraham. It reads, so, and he journeyed to the place where he had, this is chapter 13, he journeyed to the place where he had pitched his tent at the beginning, to the place of the altar with Ai on the east and Bethel on the west, and he blessed the Lord his God, who had brought him back in peace. And it came to pass in the 41st Jubilee, in the third year of the first week, that he returned to this place and offered thereon a burnt sacrifice and called on the name of the Lord and said, Thou, the Most High God, art my God forever and ever. And in the fourth year of this week, Lot parted from him, and Lot dwelt in Sodom, and the men of Sodom were sinners exceedingly. And it grieved him in his heart that his brother's son had parted from him, for he had no children. So it says in the book of Abraham, it mentions how he was grieved. It says, Abraham says, he lived in it while I was living on the mountain of Bethel, and it was disturbing to me that Lot, my brother's son, had parted from me. Jubilees says, and it grieved him in his heart that his brother's son had parted from him. That's not mentioned in Genesis, but it's mentioned in these two witnesses. So it's connection here. And likewise, we see... let me see here. No, I'll skip that part. So then it continues. In that year when Lot was taken captive, the Lord said unto Abram, after that Lot had parted from him in the fourth year of this week, lift up thine eyes from the place where thou art dwelling, northward and southward and westward and eastward. For all the land which thou seest I will give to thee and to thy seed forever, and I will make thy seed as the sand of the sea, though a man may number the dust of the earth. Yet thy seed shall not be numbered. Arise, walk in the length of it and the breadth of it, and see it all, for to thy seed will I give it. And Abram went to Hebron and dwelt there. So that's the parallel account so far. So I return to the Abraham scroll. And now we get to an interesting thing. Basically, now, instead of Abraham talking in the first person, it transitions to third person. So instead of first person, now he's talking in the third person for some reason. Why does he do this? I'm not quite sure, but we see this happen throughout Scripture. We see it in the book of Daniel. We see it in the book of Lamech. And so we see that some of these other books change from third to first person for some reason. It's probably a stylistic, it's a way of style telling a story or a change of narrative focus. Because basically, here's what happens right here. Now, Abraham is going outside of his story and backtracking. He's backtracking and saying, in line 23, he says, before these days. So he's removing himself from the narrative and saying, okay, here's the history of what happened. And I would not entirely agree with what you guys are saying here for, right here we see there were scribes that expanded on the originals, added more detail. We really need to ask the guidance of the Ruach HaKodesh. I don't believe the scribes added these details in this book right here, the Book of Abraham. I believe that this was the original book, and then Moses, he used these books to write Genesis, and then scribes did add some details to Genesis later on. They may have added a few details to some of these other books too, but for the most part, I don't believe in almost any book of Scripture that passages were added or huge details. I believe most of the time in Scripture, from what I've studied scribal differences for a very long time, many years. And I'm convinced that the scribes did not take it upon themselves the majority of the time. There might be some rare exceptions, but the majority of the time, they only added small details. A few words, possibly, or a phrase on some occasions, but not a sentence, not usually a sentence or a paragraph or anything like that. As I said, there are some exceptions, but I would say that's the rule. And again, there's exceptions to that rule. But overall, I'm convinced from my studies of all these differences that they did not add many details. They were more prone to remove details that they felt was unnecessary or that contradicted what they thought was the truth. And so that's my perspective anyway. When someone is writing in the third person, it may indicate that someone else is writing it, yes. But it also can indicate a difference of style. So, in other words, there are people today, there are still people today who write new books who sometimes they'll transition and they'll start in a first person, but then they might switch over for certain reasons. Or they might write a biography about themselves, but they'll write it in third person for some reason. They choose to write it in that style for whatever reason. Sometimes it is easier to tell a story or a narrative by taking yourself out of it and looking at it as a neutral overview. Especially if you're writing a history book, like a history textbook. Let's say you have a school and you're making a history textbook and you are a famous person. And you're writing the history textbook, and you're writing a section about yourself. Would you write, and then I did this? Probably not. In the textbook of the history of everything, you'd probably write, and then you'd put your name there and refer to yourself in the third person. So there's different ways of approaching it. And I think that We should be careful of jumping to conclusions of why we see a change of persons. That's interesting. Can you elaborate on that a little bit? You say Robert Eisenman refers to himself as the author quite often in the book you're currently reading. So like he refers to himself as like, and then Robert said this, or what does because if so, that would be an interesting parallel. Oh, okay, so the author. He refers to himself as the author. That's interesting. Yeah, there's different ways of referring to yourself. Right, and yeah, basically, here's how I approached writings, of all writings, is if a writing claims to be by someone, no matter what it is, whether it be the Bible, Buddha, everything, I believe that we are obligated to assume that it's true until we can prove otherwise. I follow a principle of innocent until proven guilty. So for example, we have many writings from George Washington. There are thousands of writings from him. When I read them, I'm not going to doubt that they're by him. But we have to be open. If there's evidence that some of his writings were not actually written by him, then we say, okay, George Washington did not write those writings. In the same way, I approach that for all literature. So I feel like if something is put into someone's mouth, we should accept that it's from that person's mouth until we see some good evidence which makes us to be highly suspicious that that was spoken by that person. And there are many examples of later writers putting things in writing in other people's mouths and writing for them as if they were the person when they really are not. And that's called pseudepigrapha often, what the scholars refer to it as. But we have to, how we judge this is through motivation. That's one of the biggest key things of looking at. What's the person's motivation for writing this? And then we see, if this is a false book, what are the implications of this? And the implications are huge because these writings are so connected to each other that if you say one writing is a fake and written by someone that's not who it was said to be written by, then that means this one has to be fake, this one has to be fake, this one has to be fake. They all have to be fake because they're all being connected to each other. So to give an example, the Book of Enoch. If we say the Book of Enoch was not written by Enoch, well, let's see what happens here. Abraham, in his scroll right here, it says he read to them the words of the Book of Enoch. Well, if Enoch was not written by Enoch, that makes Enoch not valid. It makes Abraham not valid. Jubilees says that, according to the Book of Jubilees, it says Enoch wrote a book, and Abraham wrote a book, Noah wrote a book, and Jacob wrote a book. So Jubilees would be not valid. Anything that agrees with Jubilees would be not valid. So it's like all these different things of if you take one away, it becomes a big problem. So you have to be aware of the implications. And I'm very much opposed to the idea of a vast conspiracy unless we have compelling evidence for such a conspiracy. So the more things that are connected to it and support it, the more likely it's to be true and not a conspiracy or not to be a false thing. And that's kind of what I view for these Dead Sea Scrolls and these extra writings. There's so much evidence, witness, interrelation to one another that I find it highly compelling that these writings are authentic and the true faith to restore. Right, and then so with the Dead Sea Scrolls, the translation, you have to be careful of translation errors, and then also sometimes scholars reconstruct things, and you have to be aware of that. There's principles they follow for reconstruction which are sometimes extremely off, and sometimes it's hard to read the scroll. So you always have to be aware of that. This version we're reading from, the PDF file, what's really good about it is it shows us the Aramaic text that they transcribed, then it also shows dots. A dot above a letter indicates certain dots indicate whether or not the person reading that, when they looked at the photographs or the scroll itself, if they thought that was a reliable letter or not. So if you see like a very tiny dot over a letter, that means highly certain that this is a letter, but it's hard to read. if you see a dot with like a white, if there's like a white kind of circle within a dot above a letter in this Aramaic text of the PDF file, then that means that they think that letter is that letter, but there is some doubt and some scholars differ on it. It's kind of hard. It's much harder to read that letter. So there's things like that, which you should be aware of, and that will make some differences in how it might be translated. But overall, it's a very reliable translation. The scholars are very well trained. And so I think it would be good for some of us in the future to try to translate it ourselves or to look at it ourselves to see if they made some mistakes. And also, they in this the guy who did this this translation, he used a special technology that no one else in their previous translations was using, and that was a special, I'm not sure if it was nano or some type of laser beam thing or whatever, that or infrared, I think it was infrared, which highlighted it and made it much clearer to see. And so he used that infrared, he used that to help to see if there was more he could glean. And he was able to glean some more. And the guy says, he says, unfortunately, because the scroll that was found is deteriorating with every new year, it gets in a worse and worse condition, especially if you take it out to show people. The more and more that happens, the less likely we're going to get more from the scroll. So he says it's very possible that we might have the vast majority of this scroll, the readings from it. We might not be able to improve that much at all on the readings. But perhaps maybe there can be a little more improvement and a few other words or letters here and there. But otherwise, we have pretty much exhausted the translation of this book. Now I'm going to be reading from, I'm going to be continuing now in the Abraham scroll. It says, before these days, Hedar Laomer, the king of Elam, Amraphel, the king of Babylon, Arioch, the king of Cappadocia, Tyrol, the king of Goim, which is Mesopotamia, came and waged war with Bera, the king of Sodom, and with Bersha, the king of Gomorrah, and with Shinab, the king of Adma, and with Shemiabad, the king of Zeboim, and with the king of Bela. All of these banded together for battle at the valley of Sidim. The king of Elam and the kings who were with him overpowered the king of Sodom and all of his allies, and they imposed a tribute on them. For 12 years they were paying their tributes to the king of Elam, but during the 13th year they rebelled against him, so that in the 14th year the king of Elam gathered together all of his allies. They went up the way of the desert, destroying and plundering from the Euphrates River. They destroyed the Rephaim, who were in Ashtoreth of Karnaim, the Zumzamim, who were in Amman, the Emim, who were in Shava Hakrioth, and the Hurrians, who were in the mountains of Gebal, until they reached El Paran, which is in the desert. They then turned back and destroyed Ain Dina. There's like some words missing there, and then it says, which is in Hazazon Tamar. Now the king of Sodom went out to meet them along with the king of Gomorrah, the king of Adma, the king of Zeboim, and the king of Bela. They engaged the battle in the valley of Sidim against Hedar Laomer and the kings who were with him, but the king of Sodom was crushed and fled, while the king of Gomorrah fell, and many from all, some words missing again, the king of Elam plundered all of the goods of Sodom and of Gomorrah, and all the possessions of, some words missing again, all that they found there, while Lot, the son of Abram's brother, who was living in Sodom together with them, along with all his flocks, was taken captive. But one of the shepherds of the flock that Abram had given to Lot, who had escaped from the captors, came to Abram. Now at that time, Abram was living in Hebron, and he informed him that his brother's son Lot had been captured, along with all of his property, but that he had not been killed. Also that the kings had set out the way of the great valley toward their province, taking captives, plundering, destroying, killing, and heading for the city Damascus. Then Abram wept over his brother's son Lot. Having collected himself, Abram got up and chose from his servants 318 choice warriors fit for battle. Arnon, Eshcol, and Mamre also set out with him. He chased after them until he reached Dan, where he found them camping in the valley of Dan. He swooped upon them at night from all four directions, killing among them throughout the night. He crushed them and chased after them, and all of them were fleeing before him until they reached Helbon, which is situated to the north of Damascus. He took away from them everyone they had captured, all that they had plundered, and all of their own goods. Lot, his brother's son, he also saved, along with his property. All those whom they had taken captive he brought back. When the king of Sodom heard that Abram had brought back all of the captives and all the plunder, he went up to meet him. He came to Salem, which is Jerusalem, and Abram encamped in the valley of Sheva, which is the valley of the king, the valley of Beth-Hakkerem, and Melchizedek, the king of Salem, brought out food and drink for Abram and for all of the men who were with him. He was the priest of the Most High God, and he blessed Abram, saying, Blessed be Abram by the Most High God, the Lord of heaven and earth, and blessed be the Most High God who delivered those who hate you into your hand. So he gave him a tenth of all the property of the king of Elam and his allies. Then the king of Sodom drew near and said to Abram, My lord Abram, give me anyone who belongs to me of the captives with you, whom you have rescued from the king of Elam. But as for all the property, it is left to you. Then Abram said to the king of Sodom, I lift up my hands this day to the Most High God, the Lord of heaven and earth, that I will take neither string nor sandal strap from all that which belongs to you, lest you should say, all the wealth of Abram is from my property, excluding that which my young men who are with me have already eaten, and also the portion of the three men who went with me. They have authority to give you their portions. So Abram returned all of the property and all of the captives and gave to the king of Sodom. Every one of the captives who were with him from that land he set free and sent all of them away. So I'll stop there. So this goes over through that account again of the war that happened and the capture of Lot. I'll say one other thing about the first and third person. In the book of Enoch, Enoch talks, and then at one point, now Noah is talking. So at some point it becomes Enoch talking, then Noah's talking in the first person. So basically, it may be evidence when you see something like in this scroll of Abraham, how Abraham wrote in first person, and now it's in the third person. It may be his son, Isaac, finishing it off, or someone else writing for him. Paul, in his letters, sometimes he has someone write for him. In one place, it says, I, Tertius. In Paul's letter, in one of his letters, it says, I, Tertius. And so we see that there are instances of multiple authors who were writing at that time and would write for the person, because Abraham was getting older in his days, so perhaps he had some people write for him. Who knows? But I believe that this is the book of Abraham that was written in the time of Abraham. Now I'm going to read through Genesis' account of this, and I'll point out a difference which is interesting, which suggests that Genesis has been altered. It says in chapter 14, and it came to pass in the reign of Amraphel, king of Sinar, and Arioch, king of Elasar, that Hadolamer, king of Elam, and Thargol, king of nations, made war with Bela, king of Sodom, and with Barsa, king of Gomorrah, and with Sinar, king of Adamah, and with Simabor, king of Seboim, and the king of Balak, this is Seor. All these met with one consent at the Salt Valley. This is the Sea of Salt. 12 years they served Hadolamer, In the 13th year, they revolted. And in the 14th year came Hodolomer and the kings with him and cut to pieces the giants in Ashtaroth and Karnaim and strong nations with them, and the Omeans in the city Saveh, and the Horians in the mountains of Seir, to the turpentine tree of Pharaon, which is in the desert. And having turned back, they came to the well of judgment. This is Kadesh, or Kadesh. And they cut in pieces all the princes of Amalek, and the Amorites dwelling in Assethamar. And the king of Sodom went out, and the king of Gomorrah, and king of Admah, and king of Sibaim, and king of Balak. This is Seir. And they set themselves in array against them for war in the Salt Valley, against Hodolomer, king of Elam, and Thargal, king of nations, and Amarphal, king of Sennar, and Arioch, king of Alasar, the four kings against the five. Now the Salt Valley was slime pits, and the king of Sodom fled in the king of Gomorrah, and they fell in there, and they that were left fled to the mountain country. And they took all the cavalry of Sodom and Gomorrah, and all their provisions, and departed. And they took also Lot, the son of Abram's brother, and his baggage, and departed, for he dwelt in Sodom. The part where it says that they fell into the pits, remember, as I was reading from Abraham's scroll, there were some parts missing. And that's in those missing parts, is it would have talked about the pits that they fell into. So Genesis helps us fill in some of the blanks of the scroll that was found. So then, it continues in Genesis, and one of them that had been rescued came and told Abram the Hebrew, and he dwelt by the oak of Mamre the Amorite, the brother of Eshcol and brother of Anan, who were confederates with Abram. And Abram, having heard that Lot his nephew had been taken captive, numbered his own homeborn ones 318, and pursued after them to Dan. And he came upon them by night, he and his servants, and he smote them and pursued them as far as Hobah, which is on the left of Damascus. And he recovered all the cavalry of Sodom, and he recovered Lot his nephew, and all his possessions, and the woman and the people. And the king of Sodom went out to meet him, after he returned from the slaughter of Hodolomer and the kings with him, to the valley of Sebi. This was the plain of the kings. And Melchizedek, king of Salem, brought forth loaves and wine, and he was the priest of the Most High God. And he blessed Abram, and said, Blessed be Abram of the Most High God, who made heaven and earth, and blessed be the Most High God, who delivered thine enemies into thy power. And Abram gave him the tithe of all. And the king of Sodom said to Abram, Give me the men, and take the horses to thyself. And Abram said to the king of Sodom, I will stretch out my hand to the Lord, the Most High God, who made the heaven and the earth. I will not take from all thy goods, from a string to a shoe latchet, lest thou should say, I have made Abram rich. Except what things the young men have eaten, and the portion of the men that went with me, Eshcol, Anan, Mamre, these shall take a portion. Now, this is an interesting thing. We see here that Genesis has been altered in one of these places. For it says in... says... what were the words? The words were... Then Abram said to the king of Sodom, I lift up my hands this day to the Most High God, the Lord of heaven and earth, that I will take neither string. The Genesis says, I stretch out my hand to the Lord, the Most High God, who made the heaven and the earth. I will not take from all thy goods. So there's two things right there. Or one thing right there is that the difference is, the Genesis says the creator of heaven and earth, whereas the Abraham scroll says the just Lord of heaven and earth. So it seems like the creator word was added in by Moses in Genesis, or not by Moses, but by the scribes. Let me see for a quick second. Where's the Hebrew? Okay, I have the Hebrew. I have the Hebrew, so I'll double check. That was 14:19. Or no, I'm sorry. That is 14:22. Genesis 14:22. So we see 14:22 says Abram unto king of Sodom, I have lifted my hand unto Yahuwah, God highest, the possessor of heaven and earth, the possessor of heaven and earth, the Lord God Most High, possessor of heaven and earth. In the Aramaic text of Abraham's scroll, it is my hand raised to the Most High God, Lord of heaven and earth. So it seems like there is actually an extra, it seems like Lord or Yahuwah was added into the text of Genesis. And that is actually very likely to be the case, because there's two things to say about this. In some manuscripts of Genesis, Lord appears much more often. Yahuwah appears much more often. In the Septuagint, you see Lord a lot more. And then also in Exodus chapter 3, it says, by this name I was not known to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And yet, it makes it seem like in our copies of Genesis that he was known by that name. Let me see what Exodus says. Exodus 3 says, hold on one second. Where is it? Hold on. I remember it. I couldn't find it. By name, I was not known to them. Let me see where that was quickly. But so far, basically, the account of Genesis parallels very closely. While I'm loading that, I'm going to be reading from Jubilee's section. And right now, we are at the 1:30. 1 hour and about 30 minutes. I'm going to be aiming for a 2 hour mark. If you guys have to go sooner, feel free to. This is being recorded. It's going to be on YouTube. But I'm going to try to aim for 2 hours. And we're almost done with the book of Abraham. It's very close to the end. Oh, okay. It's in Exodus chapter 6. Exodus chapter 6, verse 3 says, and I appeared unto Abraham, unto Isaac, and unto Jacob by God Almighty, or El Shaddai, but by my name, Yahuwah, was I not known to them. That sounds very much like it's saying they did not know him by that name, and so they did not use that name. So that means whenever you see in Genesis Abraham, Isaac, or Jacob using the name Yahuwah, that cannot be true. That has to be added by the scribes. And that is actually supported by the Abraham scroll and the Noah scroll and the Enoch, Book of Enoch, and the Noah and Abraham scroll, all of them, we don't see Yahuwah used at all. Of course, they were founded only in Aramaic, but at the same time, it's still, they're preferred, they have certain words they like to use, certain phrases of titles. They say Most High God, they say Great Holy One, they say King of Ages, all these different things, but they don't say Yahuwah, and they usually don't say Elohim either. So there's some differences of language being used here, in which suggests that this Abraham scroll is more archaic, more authentic. Here's another example which suggests of, let me see here, which suggests that the, okay, it's in Jubilees. It's in Jubilees, actually. And it's Abram. When Abram, in the account of Jubilees, Hebrew was lost. The Tower of Babel, Hebrew was lost. And let's see here. Okay, so Abram he's born to a family that does not speak Hebrew. He doesn't know Hebrew himself. Abram does not know Hebrew. So he says in 12:17, it says, "And a word came into his heart, and he said," this is Jubilees, "all the signs of the stars and the signs of the moon and of the sun are all in the hand of the Lord. Why do I search out?" You're going to see Hebraic roots translation of Jubilees, which will say Yahuwah there. It's going to say Yahuwah, or the divine name in that verse, 12:17, the Hebrew name. But then, let's go to Jubilees 13, where we see that he learns Hebrew. Or no, I'm sorry, it's later in the same chapter of Jubilees 12. So the verse I read was verse 17 of chapter 12 of Jubilees. He mentions the Lord. And then in verse 25 of Jubilees, that same chapter, it says, "And the Lord God said, open his mouth and his ears that he may hear and speak with his mouth with the language which has been revealed, for it had ceased from the mouths of all the children of men from the day of the overthrow. And I opened his mouth and his ears and his lips, and I began to speak with him in Hebrew in the tongue of the creation. And he took the books of his fathers, and these were written in Hebrew, and he transcribed them, and he began from henceforth to study them, and I made known to him that which he could not. And he studied them during the 6 rainy months." So we have here a clear thing where in the chapter earlier, it says Lord, but he's not speaking Hebrew. And so he did not know the name Yahuwah, and yet we see translations which say Yahuwah there. It doesn't make sense. So just like that, that's an error. We see also that the scribes of Genesis made an error. They did not realize that the name Yahuwah was not known to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob at the time. So they sometimes added it there, and sometimes they removed it. As I said, compare the Septuagint translation of Genesis with the Masoretic, the regular translations you guys are used to. And what you're going to see there is, in the Septuagint, there's a lot more Lords there that are added, Lord God, whereas in the Hebrew text, it'll either say just Lord, or it'll say just God. But in the Septuagint, in the first like 12 chapters, you're going to see almost in every place where it says either Lord or God in the Hebrew text, it'll say both in the Septuagint, Lord God. So that means that either the Septuagint scribes added God when it wasn't there, or Lord when it wasn't there, or the Masoretic scribes removed some of it sometimes because they felt it wasn't necessary. So in either case, we see evidence that the scribes believe that they can change the text for the purpose of if you remove some of the titles, it could be for condensed reasons, because maybe it's felt it's a little bit repetitive to keep mentioning the Lord God every single time. Or it could also be for consistency. There might be a couple times where it only says Lord or only says God, and so the scribe is like, why does it only say Lord there, but everywhere else it says Lord God? Maybe I should remove some of these references here to make it more consistent. So there's things like that with the scribes. They were trying to make the text be a certain way that they thought was the correct understanding. They usually didn't add details too much, but they might add words or phrases that sometimes are minor details. Like, in other words, if you see Lord God, or just Lord, or just God, it's not a huge difference, right? It doesn't change the narrative, but it does change the detail there of did they know the name Yahuwah or not. And so it's even small things like that can have major implications. But I don't believe the scribes were being sinister about that. They were out of their own ignorance. They did not realize the implications of some of the changes they're making. So we can use these scrolls, the Noah scroll, the Abraham scroll, to see how Genesis really compares with the original version of the story, and how scribes have changed it in later generations, or how Moses himself may have changed it. Some of these changes and differences may have been from Moses. We see in the New Testament, there's changes too. Like in the three gospel accounts, there's some major differences between some of the three accounts. Either that's because the gospel writers themselves changed some things, differed in some of the way they presented the story, or they may have been changed by the scribes. Yeah, the Rob speaks of the how they capitalized the Lord in place of the divine name. And it's actually funny because it seems to me like what has happened now is what the opposite of what was happening originally. So it seems that like originally in some of these scriptures it said Lord or Master or, you know, Adonai, and then it was changed to Yahuwah. This was, you know, in the way ancient times, in you know, before the Messiah. Then after, by the Greeks and by the rabbis, they changed from Yahuwah to Lord. So they went backwards. They like reversed it. It's really weird when you look at it like that. So it seems to me, I don't see much of a point in reversing Yahuwah or replacing Yahuwah with Lord. And it confuses it, because now whenever I read from the Greek, whenever I use from the Greek, it'll say Kyrios for both. In the original Septuagint, it didn't do that. In the original Septuagint, it put the divine name there. As we see some Septuagint manuscripts, the oldest had the divine name instead of Kyrios. But later on, they decided to remove the divine name, probably because they didn't understand Hebrew very well, the Greek scribes. So they just replaced it with a Greek, and they copied the rabbis probably in saying Adonai instead of Yahuwah. So they replaced it with Kyrios, and now whenever you read a Greek book of an extra book, you have to look at it and say, was the original Yahuwah there, or was it Adonai, or what was it? And it's confusing sometimes. But yeah, in the Dead Sea Scrolls also, they used placeholders sometimes for the divine name. And my perspective on that for the divine name is that sometimes when we print out his name, we have to be mindful of how and where we're printing it. So, in other words, like, I use this example sometimes, you know, like, you don't want his divine name on, you don't want the divine name on a toilet paper. You know how sometimes people print words on toilet paper? You wouldn't want that on a toilet paper. That's highly disrespectful and dishonoring of his name. In the same way, you want to make sure that when you write out his name, it's not going to be subject to irreverent usage or impure contact with things. So in some manuscripts of the Dead Sea Scrolls, they use dots, dot, 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 to signify that that's the divine name there. And I believe that practice is okay as long as you're doing it only when it's necessary and not like all the time. Because I think, you know, I think there's a time and a place to use his name. And a lot of people don't use his name at all. Or they, some people use it all the time. And I think both of those extremes are not good. I think you should use his name, but use it respectfully and reverently. That's what I see from the Dead Sea Scrolls anyway, because I see they do use that. They do use his name in the different ways. They use the placeholders, the four dots. They also write out his name regularly, and then they also write in Paleo-Hebrew. So there's three ways of doing it, all of which are valid according to the Dead Sea Scrolls. Let me see here. So now I'll kind of bet I kind of went off, you know, on a tangent. Hopefully that's okay. I'll go back now, and I'm going to be wrapping up this study with you guys. So let's see here. Jubilee's account of the same thing says, in chapter 13 of Jubilees, and in this year came Hedorlaomer, king of Elam, and Amraphel, king of Shinar, and Arioch, king of Selassar, and Tergal, king of nations, and slew the king of Gomorrah, and the king of Sodom fled, and many fell through wounds in the valley of Sidim by the salt sea. And they took captive Sodom and Adam and Zeboim, and they took captive Lot also, the son of Abram's brother, and all his possessions, and they went to Dan. And one who had escaped came and told Abram that his brother's son had been taken captive, and he armed his household servants. And then there's something missing here in Jubilees, which there might be in ancient times, something might have gotten removed here. It says, for Abram and for his seed, a tenth of the first fruits to the Lord, and the Lord ordained it as an ordinance forever that they should give it to the priests who served before him, that they should possess it forever. And to this law there is no limit of days, for he hath ordained it for the generations forever, that they should give to the Lord the tenth of everything, of the seed and of the wine and of the oil and of the cattle and of the sheep. And he gave unto his priests to eat and drink with joy before him. And the king of Sodom came to him and bowed himself before him and said, O our Lord Abram, give unto us the souls which thou hast rescued, but let the booty be thine. And Abram said unto him, I lift up my hands to the Most High God, that from a thread to a shoe latchet I shall not take aught that is thine, lest thou shouldst say, I have made Abram rich, save only what the young men have eaten, and the portion of the men who went with me, Aner, Eshcol, and Mamre, these shall take their portion. So that's the passage that corresponds there. And now I'm going to finish this Abraham scroll. So the rest that's preserved is, it's on page 102 and 83. It says, after these things, God appeared to Abraham in a vision and said to him, look, 10 years have elapsed since the day you came out of Haran. 2 years you spent here, 7 in Egypt, and 1 since you returned from Egypt. Now inspect and count all that you have. See that by doubling they have increased greatly, beyond all that came out with you on the day of your departure from Haran. And now do not fear. I am with you, and will be for you a support and strength. I am a shield over you, and a buckler for you against those stronger than you. Your wealth and your property will increase enormously. Abram said, my Lord God, I have wealth and property in great abundance, yet What are all these things to me while I, when I die, will go stripped bare without children? One of my household servants will receive my inheritance, Eleazar, son of Damasik. He, the one acquiring an inheritance from me. He said to him, this one will not receive your inheritance, but one who will go forth. And then it breaks off there, and the rest of the scroll is missing. The scholars say that it was cut off in ancient times by someone. And so I'll read the parallel of Genesis. And after these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision, saying, fear not, Abram, I shield thee, thy reward shall be very great. And Abram said, Master, Lord, what wilt thou give me, whereas I am departing without a child, but the son of Masek, my homeborn female slave, this Eleazar of Damascus, is mine heir. And Abram said, I am grieved since thou hast given no seed, but my homeborn servant shall succeed me. And immediately there was a voice of the Lord to him, saying, this shall not be thine heir, but he that shall come out of thee shall be thine heir. And then it continues with the rest of that. And Jubilees says, after these things, in the fourth year of this week, on the new moon of the third month, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a dream, saying, Fear not, Abram, I am thy defender, and thy reward will be exceeding great. And he said, Lord, Lord, what wilt thou give me, seeing I go hence childless, and the son of Masek, the son of my handmaid, is the Damasek Eleazar. He will be my heir, and to me thou hast given no seed. And he said unto him, this will not be thy heir, but one that will come out of thine own bowels, he will be thine heir. And then it continues again. And so, what we have, so what we see in the Abraham scroll, the Abraham book, there's some extra details there as well. He gives the chronology, Yahuwah talks to him about the chronology of how many years he was here and there, and also talks about his wealth, and there's no mention of the wealth in Genesis or Jubilees. Okay, I wanted to say one thing about Lord. That's actually, I believe, a false understanding. Rob mentions about Lord is Satan's title, Baal. In the Hebrew, I have studied Hebrew for many years trying to understand it myself and to restore it to the original understanding. And what I've noticed, other scholars of Hebrew will say the same thing as what I'm about to say. Basically, the word for Baal in Hebrew is actually used many times throughout Scripture and the Hebrew language in general as referring to a master over something. It's used in Scripture by Yahuwah himself as talking about having ownership over something. So many times it'll say that. In one place, in Nehemiah is talking and saying about Yahuwah. He says, Yahuwah is a Baal of fury, Baal of wrath. That they translate, how do they translate that? They don't say Baal in the translation or Lord. They say he is furious. But in the actual Hebrew text, it says a Baal of fury or a Baal of wrath. And Yahuwah says that he's going to be Baal over us. And Baal, that word Baal is used in Hebrew meaning husband. You're going to see that mean husband in Hebrew. And so, yes, Baal is a reference to a pagan deity, but so is El. El is a reference to a pagan deity as well. But we know El, you know, Most High El and Elohim. Those are not pagan terms, but there is a pagan deity by El, and there's also a pagan deity of Baal. But the word Baal can be used for Yahuwah, and it's used all throughout the scriptures. It's used for Yahuwah. It's used for husbands, but if you're not sure about that, you can look up in a lexicon. Blue Letter Bible is a great resource. Blue Letter Bible. You can look up the Hebrew words. You can look up husband. Type husband, and look in some of those passages, and you'll see some of those words that translate as husband is actually the same as Baal. And in Isaiah and some of the other prophets, Yahuwah says that he will be the Baal or the husband over Israel. So that's my thought on that. I think there's a lot of misunderstanding that people have of language in general. Like a lot of people say certain words are pagan. When I from my studies of language, a lot of those ideas that some of these words are pagan is simply not true. But it's a misunderstanding of language. But that, you know, for people who are not sure about that, I can do a study on that in the future to try to help you guys understand that if you doubt. Now, there's one other final thing to say is it's very strange. This is a very strange coincidence. And the question is it a coincidence or is it something greater? Is it God trying to test us, our faith, or to the Baal worship? He opposes Baal worship. Those who worship Baal, the deity Baal. But the word is used by the righteous prophets referring to Yahuwah in a positive designation. You can find that in the Hebrew Old Testament. Basically, what we find, which is a very striking thing, is that, have any of you guys heard of a book called The Apocalypse of Abraham? It's one of the extra books. It's called Apocalypse of Abraham. Someone mentioned earlier the Testament of Abraham. Well, there's also another book called The Apocalypse of Abraham. And that book, it starts out talking about the idolatry that Abraham went through, or not he, that he went through, but that his family was going through, and how Abraham realized that idolatry is foolish, and he rejected it, and was mocking the idols and stuff like that. I think some of that story is unreliable, some of those details I'm not sure about. I'm much less confident of that book than this book of Abraham. But as of now, I still believe that book is based on scripture, and I believe it was probably from this scroll of Abraham. What's very strange is, yeah, he destroyed his dad's idols. And what's very strange is that the Apocalypse of Abraham, the majority of it, covers a vision that is mentioned in Genesis. And it's in the exact place where the scroll of Abraham ends. So that's a weird coincidence. It's like if we had just had a little bit more of that scroll, we could have known if the Apocalypse of Abraham was valid or not. We could have known. If we had just another few columns, we would have been able to see, okay, look, the Abraham scroll has a very different version of this account here. So this Apocalypse of Abraham can't be true. And yet we don't have that. It ends at the exact place in the scroll that we would have been able to confirm or deny whether this book is valid or not, this Apocalypse of Abraham. So it's now left unclear. It's left unclear. A very strange coincidence where that exact spot. Because right as you see in Genesis chapter 15, right after he says this, he says, you know, it will not be from Eliezer, but it will be from your seed. And look at the stars and how many, if you can count them all, that will be your seed. And then it says, and Abram believed God and it was counted to him for righteousness. And then it says, take me a heifer and a she-goat and a ram and a dove and a pigeon. And then Abraham takes them, divides them, and does the sacrifice. And then he has a trance. And he sees he's told the future in Genesis chapter 15, right after this. Same thing in Jubilees. So, in this Apocalypse of Abraham, it has this vision and this account at this exact place. And it's Abraham speaking in the first person. And scholars, they make some notes of some of the similarities. They say there are some connections between the Apocalypse of Abraham and some of these other writings in themes and ideas. So it's very possible that this Apocalypse of Abraham may actually be a fragment or a portion of the Scroll of Abraham, and it's the very next section. And if that's true, that would be very amazing. So that's pretty much the only other thing I wanted to say. Other than that, I can leave to you guys this option. Are you guys satisfied with the study that we did and want to end it here? Or would you like me to, I'm not going to read the whole thing, but I can skim through a little bit of the Apocalypse of Abraham. So I leave it to you guys. your choice, because I don't want to take up too much of your time. We are at 1 hour and 55 minutes about now. So would you like me to end it here or give you guys a little bit of a preview of what this Apocalypse of Abraham says? Laura is interested. What about you other guys? I want to make sure there's a consensus. But that Abraham scroll is finished. There's no more. Yeah, it's on YouTube and in other places. But I'm going to go through it and just give you some of my insights on some of it, if you're interested. So I'm closing out Abraham's scroll. So, as I said, it begins with the idolatry account. I'm not sure how authentic it is or not, but there are some really interesting things about that. The idolatry account, like, it has names of some of the idols, and it seems hard to, not impossible, but the way it talks about the idols almost reads like someone who was immersed into idolatry. And so if Abraham wrote that account, that would be it's very realistic representation of an idolatry culture. But the Apocalypse of Abraham, as we have it, is only found in pretty much Russian Slavonic manuscripts. And it's preserved in manuscripts. Like, you know how Josephus went through like a whole history of the saints, or not the saints, the Jews, Israelites. Some Christians did something very similar, the Slavonic writers, or the Greek writers. And the Slavonic people translated it into Slavonic, and they go through it, and they go through the history of the Israelites, and they give stories here and there. They sometimes include the testaments of the 12 patriarchs and some of these other writings. So there are some valid Apocrypha portions that they have in Slavonic. And so that makes it, that indicates that this fragment. All right, thanks, Rob, for coming. And if you want to listen to the... Oh, yeah, he's already gone, but he can read. He can listen to the rest on if he wants on the recording. Yeah, there's Slavonic Josephus. I've read a little bit of that, and that's also a very interesting work. But so the Slavonic... these Slavonic manuscripts of Apocalypse of Abraham, and it's included in writings of the Slavonic people, which basically goes through the history of Israelites and includes Apocrypha stories that they know about, and they include this apocalypse here. So I think there's a very good possibility here, the scholars think it too, that Apocalypse of Abraham is a very ancient writing and Hebrew writing. So if that is true, I believe it very well may be from the Book of Abraham, at the exact place where the scroll ends. So I'll start reading. Let's see here. So it starts off... Then a voice came, speaking to me twice, Abraham, Abraham. And I said, Here I am. And he said, Behold, it is I. Fear not, for I am before the world and mighty, the God who created previously, before the light of the age. I am the protector for you, and I am your helper. Go get me a three-year-old heifer, a three-year-old she-goat, a three-year-old ram, a turtle dove, and a pigeon, and make me a pure sacrifice. And in this sacrifice I will place the ages. I will announce to you guarded things, and you will see great things which you have not seen, because you desired to search for me, and I called you my beloved. But for 40 days abstain from every kind of food cooked by fire, and from drinking of wine, and from anointing with oil. And then you shall set out for me the sacrifice which I have commanded you, in the place which I will show you on a high mountain. And there I will show you the things which were made by the ages and by my word, and affirmed, created, and renewed. And I will announce to you in them what will come upon those who have done evil and just things in the race of man. And it came to pass that when I had heard the voice pronouncing such words to me, that I looked this way and that, and behold, there was no breath of man. And my spirit was amazed, and my soul fled from me, and I became like a stone and fell face down upon the earth, for there was no longer strength in me to stand up on the earth. And while I was still face down on the ground, I heard the voice speaking, Go, Yael, of the same name, through the mediation of my ineffable name, consecrate this man for me, and strengthen him against his trembling. The angel he sent to me in the likeness of a man came, and he took me by my right hand, and stood me on my feet. And he said to me, Stand up, Abraham, friend of God who has loved you, let human trembling not enfold you. For lo, I am sent to you to strengthen you, and to bless you in the name of God, creator of heavenly and earthly things, who has loved you. Be bold and hasten to him. I am Yael, and I was called so by him who causes those with me on the seventh expanse, on the firmament, to shake, and a power through the medium of his ineffable name in me. I am the one who has been charged according to his commandment to restrain the threats of the living creatures of the cherubim against one another, and I teach those who carry the song through the medium of man's night of the seventh hour. I am appointed to hold the leviathans, because through me is subjugated the attack and menace of every reptile. I am ordered to loosen Hades, or Sheol, and to destroy those who wondered at the dead. And I am the one who ordered your father's house to be burned with him, for he honored the dead. I am sent to you now to bless you and the land which he whom you have called the Eternal One has prepared for you. For your sake I have indicated the way of the land. Stand up, Abraham, go boldly, be very joyful and rejoice. And I with you, for a venerable honor has been prepared for you by the Eternal One. Go complete the sacrifice of the command. Behold, I am assigned with you and with the generation which is predestined from you. And with me, Michael blesses you forever. Be bold, go. So it's things like that where the detail of there seems very, in many ways, authentic. There's certain minor details which might seem a little bit uncertain. But so far it seems to follow very well what we read in the Abraham scroll. And let's see here. So it does a little bit more of the account of dividing of the animals. It says that some birds came down, and it refers to the birds as Azazel. And then, let's see here. I'm skipping some of these things. So then, a little bit later, there's a lot more like discussion. There's discussion that Abraham does, and then there's a prayer that Abraham does. It's a very lengthy prayer or a praise, a song. It's a song of Abraham. Like, it starts out saying, "Eternal One, Mighty One, Holy El," and it just keeps going like really long. Just, lover of men, benevolent, compassionate, bountiful, jealous over me, patient one, most merciful, Eli, eternal, mighty one, holy, Sabaoth, most glorious, El, Yael, you are he my soul has loved, my protector, eternal, fiery, shining, and it just keeps going. There's so, like a very lengthy song. Then he sees he sees angelic beings, and then after this, he's shown the different heavens. You know, there's actually more than one heaven. Paul says he went up to the third heaven in Corinthians. There's seven heavens in Scripture, according to Scripture, and so Abram is shown the different heavens, different things about it, and he sees the Garden of Eden, and let's see, the Leviathan he saw, And it also talks about predestination. This is a good, it's a good book for predestination because it shows free will on the one hand and predestination on the other. A lot of people have a hard time accepting both, but we see, according to the Apocalypse of Abraham, that both are true. And Abraham is shown Adam and Eve's sin, the sin in the Garden of Eden. He's shown what happened. It says, and I saw there a man very great in height and terrible in breadth, incomparable in aspect, entwined with a woman who was also equal to the man in aspect and size. This is Adam and Eve, he mentions. And then, let's see here. Then he sees a prophecy of the temple, priesthood, the Israelites later on. And I think there's a... see here. Yeah, there's a whole bunch of interesting things. It talks about his father. Let me see. Let me find that's an interesting. Okay, he says, and I said, Eternal Mighty One, why did you establish it to be so and to call on the testimonies of this one? And he said to me, Hear, Abraham, and understand what I will explain to you and answer whatever I ask you. Why did your father, Terah, not obey your voice and abandon the demonic worship of idols until he perished and all his house with him? And I said, Eternal Mighty One, surely because it did not please him to obey me, nor... did I follow his works? And he said to me, Hear, Abraham, as the counsel of your father is in him, as your counsel is in you, so also the counsel of my will is ready. In days to come, you will not know them in advance, nor the future. You will see with your own eyes that they are of your seed. Look at the picture. And so we see he goes over like the predestination issue. And let's see. And he talks about Azazel. A big part of this is Azazel. And there's it seems to be a prophecy of the Antichrist too, the coming evil one. And there's prophecies of plagues. Let's see here. He says, and he said to me, I will explain to you the things you desired in your heart, for you have sought to know the 10 plagues which I have prepared against the heathen, and I prepared them beforehand in the passing of the 12 hours on earth. Hear what I tell you. It will be thus. The first, sorrow for much need. The second, fiery conflagrations for the cities. The third, destruction by pestilence among the cattle. The fourth, famine of the world, of their generation. The fifth, among the rulers, destruction by earthquake and the sword. The sixth, increase of hail and snow. The seventh, wild beasts will be their grave. The eighth, pestilence and hunger will change their destruction. The ninth, execution by the sword and flight in distress. The tenth, thunder, voices, and destroying earthquakes. And then I will sound the trumpet out of the air, and I will send my chosen one, having in him one measure of all my power. And he will summon my people, humiliated by the heathen. And I will burn with fire those who mocked them and ruled over them in this age, and I will deliver those who have covered me with mockery over to the scorn of the coming age, because I have prepared them food for the fire of Sheol and ceaseless soaring in the air of the underworld of the utmost depths, the contents of a wormy belly. For the makers will see in them justice who have chosen my desire and manifestly kept my commandments, and they will rejoice with merrymaking over the downfall of the men who remain and who followed after the idols and after their murderers. For they shall putrefy in the belly of the crafty worm Azazel, and be burned by the fire of Azazel's tongue. For I waited so they might come to me, and they did not deign to. And they glorified an alien, and an alien one, and they joined one to whom they had not been allotted, and they abandoned the Lord who gave them strength. Therefore hear, Abraham, and see, behold, your seventh generation shall go with you, and they will go out into an alien land, and they will enslave them and oppress them as for 1 hour of the impious age. But of the nation whom they shall serve, I am the judge. And the Lord said this too. Have you heard, Abraham, what I have told you, what your tribe will encounter in the last days? Abraham, having heard, accepted the words of God in his heart. So that's the end of that apocalypse of Abraham. I skipped like a good chunk of it, but I just wanted to give you guys a little bit of an overview there. So it's a very, the content I find very inspiring. Some of the information I'm not 100% certain on because there's differences in manuscripts. The Slavonic scribes sometimes took liberties with the text. So the way I basically say it is the Abraham scroll we can trust 100%. That one's the key, the foundation of the scriptures. The Apocalypse of Abraham may very likely be another portion from the lost section of the Book of Abraham. But just remember, when you're reading through the Apocalypse of Abraham, if you find anything in there that contradicts Abraham or Jubilees, then go with Abraham or Jubilees rather than the Apocalypse. Because as I said, there's some... It's not as well preserved by the Slavonic scribes. And if you want a good overview of the rest of the Book of Abraham, what's missing, what we're missing, read Jubilees. Because Jubilees fills in the blanks. And read Genesis. So take Genesis and Jubilees, the account of Abraham's life, put them together, and that's basically the Book of Abraham. And I think there was a book of Abraham mentioned in Jubilees. Let me quickly look. I'd have to find it some other time, but I'm pretty sure Jubilees says that Abraham wrote a book. See here. Double check. Yeah, I'd have to look at it some other time, but Jubilees supports the Genesis Apocryphon all the way through, like Noah and Abraham. There's just so many connections, so it really proves that these books are true. If Jubilees is true, these books are true. If these books are true, then Jubilees got to be true because they're so connected to each other. So that's pretty much the teaching for today. Do you guys have any other final questions before I let you go? Hopefully you guys enjoyed it. Alright, looks like there's no other questions. Oh wait, there's one thing. We'll see what he's going to type it. Awesome. I'm really glad you guys came, and I hope you listen to my other teachings. All right, David, have a good rest of your day and a good week. Hope to see you guys next week, and listen to my other recordings if you like to hear some other cool teachings that we've been going through. I'll answer Jonathan's question when he types it, and after that, then I'll end it. And next week, I'm thinking we're going to be doing Enoch. We're going to start going through Enoch's writings. Would you guys be interested in that? I think we might do. Oh wait, not next week. It's 2 weeks from now. 2 weeks from now, we'll be doing Enoch. Because next week I'm doing a thing for Jackson Snyder, and that's going to be the replacement. I'm not doing my regular teaching next week. I'm doing something for Jackson on his site. Okay. Psalm 12, where it talks about preserving the word. Well, let me see what that says. Okay. Let's see here. The words of Yahuwah are pure words, silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Yahuwah, thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. Okay. I assume that's what you're talking about. Basically, his words are not the scriptures. There's a difference here. The scriptures are a copy, a record of his words. His words are the actual, the voice of it. That's one thing. But then secondly, there are many copies of scripture. And it is very possible that somewhere out there, all of his word has been preserved perfectly on some scrolls that are now missing. How do we know this could be possible? Because in the Old Testament, you're going to find in the books of Kings, 2 Kings and 2 Chronicles, there's an account of Josiah, King Josiah. And what happens is that they find, so find implies that it was lost. They didn't have access to it. They didn't know about it, where it was. They found the book of the law in the temple. And then the priests bring it to Josiah so he can see it. And they read it to him. And he's listening. And he hears the law being read. And he's grieving. And he says, I cannot believe. This is horrible. So we were missing his word. His law, the very book of the law we were missing. And now we have it again. And so this indicates that that copy was still there. It was preserved. That was a preserved copy. But other people did not have access to it. To this very day, not everyone has a copy of the Bible in their language that they can read and understand. His words are preserved, but they're not preserved for everyone to read. And they're not necessarily preserved on a piece of paper either. They might be preserved in the... Basically, when he speaks something, it's true. Prophecy, the power of prophecy, that remains in force. Even if you were to destroy every Bible in the world, that will not destroy his words, because his words are superior to a piece of paper. So that's kind of how I approach it. I just see the evidence, a large amount of evidence, shows there's so many errors in Scripture, not so much intentional errors of false stories that people wanted to make, but rather people remove things that they felt weren't necessary, and that makes errors. And then they sometimes corrected things that they thought was wrong, and which really wasn't, so they messed it up that way. They might have added words for clarity, which they thought they were clarifying and making it more, making the truth more understandable, but they were actually making it less understandable, or actually twisting what the original meant. There's things like that, but I don't believe there was pretty much, except rare exceptions maybe, there was pretty much not ever any scribes who like, okay, let's write a narrative about this, and let's write that so that, you know, even though we know it's false, even though we have no evidence that this is a true story, we're going to write it to deceive people, or to make it say what we, our own imaginations. I don't think the scribes ever did that. I don't see evidence for that, because I've been studying these things for years. I see there's major changes, major problems with Scripture, but they're changes made and issues that came about through accident and unintentional unintentional distortion of the original message. They were not intending to corrupt it so badly. So if someone was trying to corrupt the Scriptures really intentionally, they were trying to corrupt it, then you can't rely on Scripture anymore. It's unreliable. But if Scripture was corrupted unintentionally, then you can rely on Scripture, because now we know these people were trying to preserve the Scripture's message. They were trying. They were doing their best. Maybe not their best, but they were doing what they thought was the right thing. And so we can see these differences, the Scriptures being lost, and we can see, don't let this discourage you. Let it inspire you, because, wow, there's even more of his word out there that we don't have. And let's find it so that we can teach ourselves and so we could easily, so we can better ourselves. And when we see other people teaching things, like these major teachers out there, all you have to do is just look and see what they say, compare it to these other writings, and if these other writings contradict them, then reject what they say. Go with the scriptures. All right, good to have you guys. I'll end it now. Shalom, and hope to see you guys next week. And we can talk on Facebook if you need to ask me any more questions. All right, shalom, you all.